Good morning, church. How are we doing today? It's a bright sunny morning. Only going to be 90-something today.
Oof.
97? I don't like your attitude. I think we better stand and sing and get all excited, and then, you know, we can get hot and sweaty and...
Let angels prostrate all, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Woo-hoo!
Here to praise Jesus.
We come before you now this morning to lift you up in praise and worship. Our hearts are hungering for your touch today, Lord. We ask that you bless Pastor Ron with the message that he brings for us. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit amongst us this morning as we sing worship and praise to you, for you are worthy. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Announcements. I don't have any. I am not Rudolph's cousin. This is called rosacea. And believe it or not, it's better than it was last week. I've been on the medication for it for a few days now, so it's starting to turn back a little bit. So don't worry, I don't have leprosy. I'm not going to infect anybody. It's not catching, except for my mother. She gave it to me. Oh, my daughter thanks me all the time. Oh, well, you know, we all got something, don't we?
Yeah.
And we go through it. And God provides the way and the strength and the power. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Prayer circle. Speaking of prayer, don't we all do that. We have prayer circle at 10 o'clock on Thursday mornings over in the Ocotillo room. Unless you prefer to sit in the Saguaro room, we'll talk louder. The movie next week, not this week, but next week, is Running the Bases. Yes, it's a baseball movie. Pastor Ron is having a harder time finding movies that are of quality acting and message. So if you know something, offer a suggestion to him. He's more than willing to take suggestions, except mine. That's okay. That's all right.
Nobody wants to see Die Hard.
I was going to say Last of the Mohicans, but that's okay. Come and see this movie. It's got a great message. It's true. It's about some sports. A lot of the movies this season have been about sports, but they all have a message, and that's the important part. Amen?
Amen.
Come and see. My wife has already voluntold me to make popcorn, so we'll have popcorn, too. You like popcorn, right? Okay. Oh, yeah? Jim's all over the popcorn. Gentlemen, if you'd come forward, please. These are our fine organizations. We are still giving to Home of Hope Team Challenge. We give to Sunshine Acres up in Mesa. Both of these organizations are about kids and young adults, right? We know this. And so it's a worthy cause to give to. Going to begin giving to the Grace Home Children's Home in Kenya. That is I forgot the name of what that is. It's a home for kids.
Right. Orphanage.
That's the word I couldn't remember. It's an old brain. It doesn't work right sometimes. This is an orphanage organization. It's really good, very powerful, doing great work in the community. Christ Aid International is working with a group out of Sweden in a specific area of Kenya or Uganda, and they have built homes for grandmas to watch over the kids, and they are supporting kids going to school and building schools, and it's a good organization. They even have a doctor on staff that takes care of all the needs of the teachers and the administrators and the kids when they need it, and the grandmas as well. So all these are great organizations working with kids. Amen?
Amen.
Heavenly Father, this morning we bring before you these four organizations. They are worthy and they are capable of doing your work, great work in their communities. And we thank you that we have the opportunity to give to them, that we may push their work and their efforts ever farther, that you may be glorified wherever they are. And we love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Call.
Bless you, Lord, for these offerings. Is Christ your vision this morning? Do you look through his eyes?
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to be saved.
About, I am your light. When you are in my presence, you have no lack. I will light your way. I will lead you on the right path. Isn't that a glorious thought?
Amen.
Amen. Here's an old one now, Cynthia, Cecilia. With a bit of a little jazz.
You alone, my heart is desire.
place our trust. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. Stone, the solid ground, firm through the fiercest thought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when tidings cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God to helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, thrown by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Strength and our power and our wisdom. We don't even stand in our money. We stand in Christ the Lord. He is the only way. You are our precious Savior, our Lord, our Christ, our Comforter, the lover of our souls. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for your presence, for your love. You are so wonderful. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Yes.
I could just call it good and go home from here.
Okay.
Worshiping.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, isn't God good?
All the time.
I see some of you here that has been in the hospital and been sick, and you're all here today. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Woo! Woo! Have you enjoyed those songs we did today?
Yes.
I really enjoyed those. We, Ed and I come over here on Saturday afternoon and set up, and we go through all the songs and make sure that things are capitalized, it should be, or the right words are up there. We go through that, and we get so blessed just going through the songs. And I said, some of these songs we did today, we should just do every week. What do you think? What do you think?
No.
Yes, I think we should do them every week.
All summer long.
All summer long. Well, yeah, well, you're not here. We have been, Ed and I have been speaking about maybe the fifth Sunday of a month to have more singing than anything. I'll still preach some, but we're going to do a lot of singing. And that comes up in June. It's hard to believe that a 30-day month is going to have five Sundays, but start thinking about some of the songs you'd like to hear, and we'll let you come up and lead them. No, but let us know on some of the songs that you'd like to hear, and we'll put those together, see if we can find the background and make it easier for you to come up and lead. Okay?
Still no.
Still no. Okay, well, boy, I love the enthusiasm. I saw this on Facebook this week, and I thought it, I don't know if it falls in with the sermon or not, but it's okay. But if you look at it, if you can see it, it really makes a lot of sense. Some people say, I'm too young to seek God. I'm too independent to seek God. I'm too happy to seek God. I'm too busy to seek God. I'm too tired to seek God. It may be too late to seek God. I thought that's pretty good. The scripture says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he was near. Amen?
Amen.
That's pretty good, wasn't it? Okay, that's a sermon for the day. Boy.
Tough crowd.
We're going to continue on with the temptation of Jesus today. And as you remember last week, we started with the first temptation that Jesus had that Satan took him through. There's a story, I want to tell you a little story about a prophet of old, and you may recognize this guy's name. His name is Elijah. Remember Elijah out of 1 Kings? He was the last prophet of his time. Israel was worshiping Baal and other gods, and Elijah called Ahab together all the 450 prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. Remember the story? And the test was that let's all sacrifice. You guys go first, and you sacrifice to your Baal and all these. Set up your altar and do all the things you need to do. And then when you get through, then I, Elijah, will set up an altar to God and pray to him. And so you remember the story, all of those 450 prophets got together and they said, we can do this. So they started early in the morning and they set up a beautiful altar and they cut up all the sacrifices and put out there and they prayed and they prayed and they prayed until about noon. And about noon, Elijah comes up and says, hey guys, what's happening here? Maybe your God's sleep until the afternoon. Maybe they're not hearing you. Maybe you need to shout and pray louder. Come on, guys. Pray louder to your gods. And so that really made them mad, and they kept praying on and on and on. Nothing all afternoon. Till finally he says, all right, guys, you've had enough. Baal and your gods are not the one true God. Let me show you the power of God. Remember the story? He moved all the other stuff out of the way. He had him dig a trench around the altar. He built it up with rocks. He has it all prepared. Then he cuts up the sacrifice, puts it on there. And then he says, oh, by the way, I think that you guys need to go and get some big jars of water and come and dump on this altar. Because, you know, if it just starts a fire, you know, what good is that going to do? So let's pour water. So they come and they pour the water, gets in the trenches a little bit. Oh, let's do it again. And then they get that and they pour it on. They did it again and again until the whole sacrifice was totally soaked and the trench around it was full. There ain't no way that sacrifice is going to burn, right? And he gets out there and he says, Lord in heaven, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, hear our prayer today and show them who's really God. And immediately, fire came down from heaven and consumed everything that was there, even the water. And he says, this is the one true God. Amen?
Amen.
Wow. Now, what does that do with the temptation? I don't know. I just thought I'd tell that story. No, it's the power of God. You know, we serve an almighty God that has the power to for everything that we possibly need in life. Amen? Anything that we have or anything that we need, God provides. So let's look at last week. Now, last week, we talked about seeking God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Amen? We talked about giving God, seeking Him in everything that we do. Then we talked about that the first thing when Jesus came, before He was getting ready to do the ministry He had as a human here on earth, that He came to the water of the Jordan, and He was baptized by John the Baptist. Remember, John says, oh, I don't deserve this. You're the one that should be. And God says, you know, this is to fulfill the prophecy. So when this happened, the voice from heaven came down and said, He says, you are my beloved son. In you, I am well pleased. Wow. I like that. I hope when I get to heaven, God will tell me that. So Jesus is our example. He fulfilled the prophecy. This is how He began His ministry. Then we know that the scripture says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. For 40 days and 40 nights, He fasted and became hungry. Remember we talked about the fasting? Remember we talked about that? That fasting is essentially giving up food for a certain length of time. And during that time, we can pray, we can meditate, we can look to the Lord, worship Him, whatever's required during that time of fasting. And I won't have you raise your hand, but how many of you have ever fasted? Now, maybe not 40 days and 40 nights, but there are things in this life today, or decisions that we need to make, that maybe we need God's direct input and wisdom to make the right decision. So maybe we need to fast and pray and worship Him. And remember, Jesus says, Jesus says, we don't live by the bread alone. Well, the first temptation He has, He says, then the tempter came to Him and said, if you are the Son of God. Now, Satan loves to tempt us, doesn't he? If you are a child of God, then. But He's coming to Jesus and He said, if you are the Son of God, then turn these stones into bread so you can eat. Satan loves to tempt us, doesn't he? So we talked about this a little bit, how Jesus could have turned the stones into bread, but yet he said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of his mouth. No matter what Satan is throwing our way today, don't give up. Don't give in to what Satan has, because he will tempt you with everything. So the first temptation was about self. It's all about me. Satan would rather you say, you know, whatever's the best for you, that's what Jesus wants, right? He wants the best for you. So just do whatever you want, what matter if it makes you feel good. It's all about you. Buy that new car. Buy that new house. It's all about you. You don't need it. You don't need anything else. Doesn't God want everything great for you? Huh? So the first thing he tempted him with was to doing things selfishly. Humanism. Remember we talked about that? Well, now today is the second temptation that Satan did. And it says, then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him up on a pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God. He just asked him that on the last one. Oh. If you are the Son of God, then throw yourself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge over you. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Wow. So Jesus just jumped down off this big old temple, and you'll get wings and you'll fly away. That's my interpretation of what the scripture says. Now, in the temptation that is listed, there's only two gospels that list exactly what the temptations were. That is Matthew, and that is Luke. And just two places that's mentioned. Well, I like the very first. I like Matthew. If you look at Luke, for some reason Luke switches the second and the third temptations. Now, maybe he doesn't. Maybe those are the correct. You know, maybe it is his interpretation. But Matthew does it this way. And the reason I think I like to work on this one is because in both first and second one, it says, if you are the Son of God. Both of them say that. If you are the Son of God. Now, Satan knows that Jesus is the Son of God. But he's tempted him. He says, if you are truly the Son of God, then do this. Do this. Now, I find it a little strange on this second one that Satan is not only saying, if you are the Son of God, but then he quotes Scripture. Isn't that weird? Satan knows enough about God and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit to know that he knows exactly the Scripture. So he brings it up. He brings this up the Scripture from the Old Testament. Why does he do that? Why does he do that? It's because he really wants Jesus to be able to be tempted. We go through the same temptations that Jesus went through. Amen? I mean, these are the examples of temptation. The first one was selfishness. It's all about me. No, it isn't about you. It's about your relationship with Jesus Christ, and it's about him first. The second one is about power. The second one is all about power. Satan says, if you are the Son of God, just throw yourself off of there. Now, this is the very beginning of Jesus' ministry. Okay? You with me? This is the first, this is before he started into the ministry, before he selected the disciples. This is him being tempted in the wilderness. So the second thing, throw yourself off. Wouldn't that have been a great miracle for people to see? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, throwing himself off a temple, and the angels come and gather him up and don't let him even get hurt. Wouldn't that be a great miracle? But that wasn't God's plan. That wasn't God's plan. Now, as I look at this, I see that we need to be trusting God in everything we do. Amen? And I'm going to be a little bit blunt here, but there's a lot of people out there today that you'll hear that'll say, you know, I became a Christian. I had Jesus Christ forgave me my sins, and that's all I need to do. I can go off and do anything I want to do, and if I mess up, God's going to come and he's going to rescue me. He's going to rescue me from whatever I do because God loves me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, right? So he loves you. So he'll rescue you anytime you decide to go off and do whatever you want to do. If you've watched the movie Groundhog Day, and you see that he's trying to figure some way of killing himself, and one of the things he did was drive off into that pit in a truck, and go all the way down because he's thinking, maybe this will kill me, and he gets down to the, and it crashes and blows up. Remember that? There's things that we do in life that maybe God doesn't want us to do. And yet we're testing all the time. I want to read to you, if you've got your Bibles, we're getting a little bit away from Matthew, and that's okay. We're going to go to the book of Psalm. If you'll open your Bibles or get your phones out and look this up. Psalms 91. This happened to be one of my mother's favorite psalms. And I like reading this once in a while, and if you've received a get well card or encouragement card from the church, and sometimes I'll sign that and I'll put Psalm 91. Because I love to hear these words. But listen to the words of this. Ties right into what Satan is tempting Jesus. If you're with me, I'm going to start at verse 1 of Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, in God, my God, in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by, nor the pestilence that stalks the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right side, but it will not come near you. Praise the Lord, that God will protect us as long as we're in His will. If I decide to go off and jump off a mountain because I just want to test God and see if He'll save me, that's not God's will that you do that. This is saying that if you are within God's will, He will protect you. He'll put His wings of the eagle. It says, if you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge, then no harm shall befall you. But it says there's first, even the Lord, who is my refuge. Follow Jesus Christ as your Savior and follow His plan for your life. And then it says, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. For He will command His angels concerning you to guard you in all of your ways. And they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Sound like what Satan was tempting Jesus with, right? You will tread upon the lion and the cobra, and you will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him from the acknowledge it, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. That's exactly what Satan was trying to tempt Jesus with. Jesus, use all this power that you have. Use all this power you have and show people that you are God, if you are the Son of God. Power. People today want power. Want power. Look at some of the politicians. I want the power of being a politician. Wow. But Jesus says in His own way. There is most of you who know me know that I like westerns. And I've probably seen every episode of Rifleman probably at least 100 times, maybe more. I can almost tell you when they start talking. I can just follow along with all the words that they're saying because I almost know them by heart. And Linda gets awfully upset when I turn on a western. But there was one episode that I watched recently, and probably a week before that, and a week before. Anyway, there's one where this one dad, he's old and he's having a hard time getting around, and he comes into town with his wounded son, who happens to be the fastest gun around. You've probably seen that one, I guess, if you watch Rifleman. And he comes in and he's trying to get help for his son who's injured. And he's walking around town going, don't you bump into me because I'm going to go get my son and he's going to shoot you. And he's always bragging that my kid is better and faster than you are. And then when he finds out that his son can't shoot anymore because he's been injured, guess who's coming to town now? It's the son's son, who is faster than dad. So he rides out and he comes back in. He says, All right, you pick on me, you push me around, I'm going to go to my grandson. He's faster than dad. But how often do we in life say, you know, my God is more powerful than anything that can come about, and no matter what I do, God's going to come and rescue me. We think that's kind of funny, but, you know, God will rescue you if you're following in His will, right? Right? How many TV shows have we seen that, you know, we're going to call the A-team, they'll come and save us. We're going to call the equalizer because she'll come and she'll save us. It's not how God acts. It's not one of those where we get in trouble and we say, oh, God, come save me. Come save me. And that's what Satan was trying to get across to God. You are Almighty Son of God. Just throw yourself off, and God is going to send His angels to protect you, and you're not going to get injured. And he says, that's not the will of the Lord today. Jesus replied and said, it is written again, you shall not tempt or test the Lord your God. Is there times in your life when you're just trying to tempt the Lord? Not good. Amen? Paul says in 1 Corinthians, we must not put... Now, listen to this. Got your ears open? Nobody's asleep, Mike. You must not put Christ to the test as some of them did. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and He will not let you be tempted above your ability. But with the temptation, He will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. If God is testing you, remember the story of Job. Okay, he was doing all well and good. He had his family and all his kids and all the livestock, and everything was going well for him. And Satan comes to God and says, you know, if you weren't protecting him, how many of us today could take that type of temptation that even Job was tested with? He didn't test the Lord, but God allowed Satan to test Job. We get tested each and every day. God will allow. God does not lead us into temptation. He doesn't test us, but He will allow Satan at times to say, come and allow Satan to test you. But we need to rely on the Lord, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not into your own understanding, follow His will for your life, and trust and have faith in the Lord. You know, a lot of times as a Christian, we have to go through those tests each and every day to get our faith in the Lord stronger and stronger. With new tests comes stronger faith. Stronger faith. You know, when we were younger, if we became a Christian and we've gone through all these tests and our faith has endured over time and time and time, and then when we get older, I didn't say old, so when we get older and something happens to us and we break a stomach muscle and we bleed all internally and the pain is great there, we can trust in the Lord and say, Lord, I know that there's a reason for this. Touch me, touch my body, get me through this and show me your direction. It may be laying there looking up, and that's the only way thing you can do is look up. Lord, I see you. Okay? But God will have a plan, and even through the hardest temptations, you'll have that faith to grab a hold of the Lord. You remember Carol Moody? I love her to death, and she'd be sitting down here, and she'd say, hang on, baby. You've seen that, where that little cat's holding on to the, hang in there, baby. Hang in there, baby. Matthew 20:28, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he said, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, listen to this, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Jesus gives us the power and authority to go preach his word and to speak to others around us if you follow his direction. There's a lot of people out there today, and I don't know if I brought this story up, but I used to work with a gentleman that we worked in the electronics field. And this guy was a dedicated Christian, and he felt a need to always preach and proselytize to everybody around him. And so when some of the workers made, and they shouldn't have done this, but they made some porn videos to watch to test the machines. And so he found those and he destroyed them. And he made the people mad at him to where they didn't want anything to do with him. Really, they weren't good. But he would go out of his way to destroy and damage his relationship with the people that he worked with. Maybe that's not exactly what God wants us to do. You know? I mean, there's other ways of destroying evil in our world today. But follow God's leading. You know, I think I need to go to my next door neighbor and preach to them because they're not doing things they should be doing. And I'm going to just make it upon myself to go do it. And you don't ask God for that he'll be with you, you just go on your own. Guess what? It may be a total flop. You may turn that neighbor into a person that wants to have nothing to do with you. But if God says, today's the day, go next door, and he will give you scripture, he will give you the words, he will give you all you need to preach his word to your neighbor. Don't do it on your own. Don't do it on your own. Luke 10 says, behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because that your names are written in heaven. Hey, guess what? I'm a Christian. I'm better than you. If you don't leave me alone, I'm going to call my son, and he's a faster draw than you are. I'll call God. He's got power. That's not what the Lord wants us to do, amen? Don't take it upon ourselves to take all that power and think you can use it to your glory instead of the Lord's. Wow. Put God first in all that you do. The second temptation today is the temptation that we may take God's word and twist it into our own way of thinking instead of giving him all the glory. Let him use his power to direct you and give you wisdom today. Amen? Jesus says, it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Keep your eyes focused on him today. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, today I pray that you just help us to stay focused on you. Lord, please lead us in what we need to do. We know that you give us all the authority and the power to do your will in our life and those that are around us today, but God, let us not take it for granted that we can just use that power to our own benefit. Lord, help us to seek you first. Help me, Lord, never to be tempted for doing anything for my own personal gain. Lord, help me to always trust in you and remain focused on you. Help me to lean upon you each and every day. And I ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Stand with us today as we close. Thank you for coming today. Thank you for coming today. Thank you. Well, as we have a closer walk with thee, let's go from this place rejoicing in the Lord. I heard only one or two. Rejoicing in the Lord.
Amen.
And go share Christ today. May the God of grace and love and glory go with you today as you leave this place. You are dismissed.